I represent clinical science. So I work mainly with patients. I'm a professor here at the Institute of Physiology and Pharmacology at the Karolinska Institutet, and I'm also working at the Department of Pediatric Anesthesia and Intensive Care just in the new hospital across the road. So I work with actual patients and center my research around patients, and a lot of you, I guess, haven't seen many patients yet. So I hope that I can make this into something that is interesting and that you can digest, not only your sandwiches. It's now about 40 years since I was a medical student in these very rooms. And at that time, Sting and the Police was very, very popular as a pop group. And they had a smash hit with Every Breath You Take. And this is just to illustrate for you what an anesthesiologist and an intensive care doctor in fact does. We observe every breath you take, every move you make, and we will be watching you. And that's how we work, and that's how we hopefully save lives. Yeah. Then there is a quote from myself. There is plenty more in an exhalation than warm, moist air. And you can, in fact, measure in exhaled air exogenous stuff that you consume. One of the most frequent ones is when you were stopped by the police driving a car and breathalyze you to see if you will exhale ethanol or alcohol. That is widely known if you are treating patients with asthma or airway inflammation. You can ask the patient to breathe into an analyzer that measures exhaled nitric oxide. And nitric oxide is a product of inflammation. So if you do that regularly, if you have asthma, you will detect the deterioration in the asthma disease much, much earlier than the patient's in fact starting to get more serious symptoms. And then you can initiate treatment much faster. So measuring things in exhaled air is quite interesting option. But first and foremost, we breathe to get oxygen in and carbon dioxide out. All of you know that. I know that much. So this is what this, in fact, all deals with, or is the fundament for the research. And we are a group that are working with Capnodynamics, and Capno is then having to do with CO2, carbon dioxide, and dynamics is, of course, how that kind of moves in relation to other things. And we are then working with a method where you, in fact, continuously can assess lung volume, which is ELV, or in brackets FRC, I'll come back to that, or effective pulmonary blood flow, that in the absence of areas of the lung that is collapsed, that do not take part in ventilation, but are still perfused. That happens in disease states, not in you guys sitting here, that have open lungs. But effective pulmonary blood flow is equal to cardiac output. And those things are very, very important to us. I would also like to say that we are working with the industry in this. So it's a combined effort by the medical university and the Makea critical care company. Okay, first of all, trying to tell you if we have a problem and what that might be due to, like this TV repairman. What we in fact are interested in is what's happening here at the alveolar level in the lung, where you see this network of capillaries taking deoxygenated blood and making it into oxygenated blood. And this is just an illustration of this. You see the blood flowing through. You see the alveoli here. Oxygen comes in and carbon dioxide comes out. Very basic. We in fact already have quite good methods of monitoring ventilation to see what ventilation is doing. So the end result we can monitor quite well already. There is arterial blood gas analysis. I think that you might have heard of that. You take a sample from the artery and not the vein, and that will tell you how much oxygen is in the blood and how much carbon dioxide there is in the blood, and also the pH, basically. which are very, very fundamental things. By just attaching a small probe on a finger with a red light, you can, in fact, know how much of the blood is oxygenated, peripheral oxygen saturation. That is a value that should be somewhere between 95 and 100 in a normal patient. And we can also measure how much carbon dioxide comes out with every breath. And that is then what we have built this on. This is a little bit of a repetition about lung volumes. How many of you have seen this graph before? Most of you. And I would just draw, here you see tidal breathing. You breathe in and out, that's about half a liter per every breath, and you breathe about 10, 12 times a minute as you sit here. But as you have exhaled a normal breath, you still have air in your lungs, which is called functional residual capacity. And this point is in Swedish called andningsmedelläge. And that is extremely important. Most medical students, most doctors don't really understand how important FRC is. And I'll come back to explain to you why that is important. You draw air into your lungs by creating a negative intrathoracic pressure, mainly your diaphragm going down, and then you suck air in. So you will create a pressure difference between ambient air and the negative pressure inside. If you're in the ventilated, it's the other way around. Then you have a positive pressure pumping air into your lungs. But you have a pressure difference. And with this difference, you will have a volume of air coming into your respiratory system and down into your lungs. And then you, of course, get a curve with this hysteresis curve. And you can see if you move this much when it comes to pressure. If you do that where this curve is very steep, you will generate a very huge volume of air coming in. If you let the lung collapse, you will hardly get any air in because it needs much, much bigger pressure to get air into the lungs. Or if you overdistend the lung, it's the same. And also if you ventilate here, which is the lower inflection point, and this is the upper deflection point, you might injure the lung. So it's very important that you ventilate on this steep part of the lung. And approximately in the middle here, in normal circumstances, you have FRC. So it's very, very important to preserve FRC. If you give a muscle relaxing drug, your muscle tone will go away. So then your rib cage will shrink because it doesn't have the muscles keeping it expanded. And then you will go down here, down here. And the way to manipulate where this FRC point is on this curve is called end expiratory pressure, positive end expiratory pressure. So if you put a resistance against breathing out, you will, of course, keep the lung better open, especially if you don't have the muscle tone that you should. So this is also a very, very important thing when you come to mechanical ventilation, that is positive end expiratory pressure. Now you will learn something that most have not thought about, and that is that the majority of gas exchange, in fact, does not take place when you take a breath in and out. It takes place when you're doing the respiratory pause. I said that you will breathe about 10 times a minute now. That means that every breath cycle is 6 seconds. It takes a second to make one breath. But then you have a respiratory pause of 5 seconds. And for obvious reasons, that's when the gas exchange takes place. And gas exchange then takes place against FRC, the volume of lung that is still in your lungs after a normal breath. And it's only a small part of that, that you're not washing that out entirely with each new breath. So to have a reasonable amount of FRC is very, very crucial. And as I said before, if you ventilate the lungs with a mechanical ventilator or respirator, it's the best ventilation, at least traumatic ventilation, both in healthy and diseased lungs, if you do that around the FRC value, where this curve, as I showed you, is the steepest. How big is the FRC? In healthy lungs, it's about 30 milliliters per kilogram. If you get acute lung injury or acute respiratory distress syndrome, which is a very, very frequent condition in intensive care units, both in adults and children, it's a little bit less. There are methods that can, in fact, measure FRC. And you can use that in the physiology, pulmonary physiology lab, where you can get patients in to do that. Or you can do it in research situations. And that is usually variants of inert gas wash in, wash out. Helium is not taken up, you wash it into the lung, and then you can follow how does it wash out, and then you can calculate FRC. That's pretty straightforward, but you cannot use that under anesthesia or in the intensive care because it's just too difficult to do. So to really get the method that would be very easy to use, and of course also reliable and precise, would be of great value for us that are doing anesthesia and intensive care. Okay, that was why is measuring lung volume and FRC of importance? Why is it important to monitor cardiac output? Together with getting oxygen in and getting carbon dioxide out of the lungs, the next most important function of all in the body, I would say, is oxygen delivery. Because if you can't deliver oxygen to your tissues, you will just die. And this is the equation that is responsible for oxygen delivery. Of course, it depends on how much hemoglobin you have in your blood, the concentration of hemoglobin. This is a factor saying that each gram of hemoglobin can bind 1.34 milliliters of oxygen. Of course, the amount of hemoglobin also depends on how well it's saturated. If it's 50% saturated or 100% or whatever it is. So that is also important. But the most important thing is the cardiac output that then will pump that type of blood out into the body. So to increase or decrease oxygen delivery, this is the most important factor. That is also very, very important to understand. You can help this by adding some hemoglobin, giving a transfusion. You can increase the percent of oxygen that you inhale, but that is only minor compared to increasing cardiac output, for example. So that is very, very important. And it's measured in milliliters of oxygen per minute. So it's very interesting for us to monitor and also to trend. In our business, it's very important to trend over time how things change. If they start to decline, if they increase, or if they're stable. So trending is almost as important as being precise and accurate. Maybe the value is a little bit off compared to some sort of true value, but it follows the course very nicely, and that is very important. But there are a lot of methodologies to do this. There is really no gold standard on how to measure cardiac output. There are some that there is a consensus that they are the best, but they may be invasive. You have to put the catheter into into your body, into your bloodstream. You can only measure it now and then, intermittently. They drift and need recalibration. And for me and my friends working with really tiny babies and small children, these things are just too huge to fit into these patients. So we don't have access to it, even if we want to. What we in fact can do, and something that is also closely related to cardiac output, is in fact how much carbon dioxide you exhale. And this is a capnogram. And we regularly measure capnograms in our patients, both in anesthesia and intensive care. And these are high precision methods, easy to use. You just attach a thing to your breathing system, sucks a little bit of air, or it measures it with infrared light in the air, and you can get this curve. Here there is nothing coming out. You see that now we start to exhale. This part is then emptying the dead space. You remember the dead space, some of you at least. And here, up here, the first and fastest, the best alveoli are emptying. There carbon dioxide. And the, about here, it's the slowest or worst alveoli. So if you have a pretty healthy lung, this is almost horizontal. If you have asthma, where the different parts of the lungs empties in sequence, because some is fast, some are slow, you will get a capnogram that looks like a shark fin, more or less. for all of you, I think you understand that the area under this curve is the amount of carbon dioxide that is exhaled with each breath. So the area under the curve times the number of breaths per minute will then be CO2 elimination. How many milliliters of CO2 that is in fact exhaled every minute. So I hope that that is, if it's not too badly complicated. Nothing is new under the sun. Medical history and science has been around for about 150 years in its present form. I saw a very interesting program on television about Egyptian insight into medicine just yesterday, and they understood a lot that I didn't understand that they understood. So everything has history. So in fact, if you know how much carbon dioxide that is exhaled every minute, we can then get that number. We can also, from the capnogram and doing stipulations, I'll come back to that, estimate the difference between the carbon dioxide concentration in the blood coming to the lung and then from the lung. So if you divide that, you will in fact get cardiac output. You can do the same with oxygen. If you know how much oxygen that is taken up by the lung every minute, you also know how much oxygen is before the alveoli and after the alveoli. You can do the same type of calculation and get cardiac output. And this guy, Adolf Fick, figured this out already in the late 19th century. So what is it that we in fact do? Here you can see a train of breaths by the ventilator, and you can see that some are kind of brief and some are longer in duration. So they in fact do not look the same. They are still within the normal limit of breaths that we take. If you want to say something, you breathe in a little bit bigger just to be able to speak a little bit longer. So with these short breaths, there will be less carbon dioxide coming out, and with these longer breaths, there is more carbon dioxide coming out, basically. So there will be a difference in this end-tidal CO2 concentration between these breaths. And then you go back to your high school math, and you know that you could solve equation system of three different equations. And now instead we create 10 different, and then you need extremely complicated math and working with MATLAB and stuff like that, and I cannot tell you how to do this. But we do have guys who are very clever. So you have a set of 10 equations, and that is then updated with every new breath. So the first breath is thrown off and the 11th breath is counted in, and then it just moves on. So with each new breath, you get a new value for both effective pulmonary blood flow, which is cardiac output, and effective lung volume, which is something that is very, very close to FRC. So that is pretty cool. So we have a breath-by-breath monitoring of ELV, which is FRC basically, and EPBF, which is cardiac output. You can then change this sequence or the type of breaths by either producing an inspiratory hold, you take in the air and then make a pause and then exhale, or you can prolong the expiratory pause. So there are just two different methods. I'll come back to that a little bit later. So this is in fact what it is. Now everybody just freezes, and this is complicated math, and I'm just turning my brain off because this is just too complicated. No, it's not very complicated, and we will not go into detail. This is in fact just to tell you the simple, easy idea that it's obvious that the lung cannot eliminate more carbon dioxide than the circulation brings to the lung. That is, so cardiac output is of course of paramount importance. How much of that content can be exhaled? That depends on how much of the lung that in fact participates in gas exchange. So if the lung is very, very, very small, then there will be very little. If it's bigger, if you breathe faster, the effective lung volume then is a measure of the part of the lung that takes takes part in actual gas exchange. And as I said to you before, to what volume do you in fact do your gas exchange? That is FRC. So ELV and FRC are extremely close relatives. They are not exactly the same, but they're very closely interrelated. So what do you need for this to work? You will need to have put down a tube into the patient's trachea with a balloon so it's tight, airtight. You can't allow air to escape. You need to take full control. You need to provide mechanical ventilation with this type of preset train of 10 or 9 breaths. It requires a very, very accurate and fast CO2 analyzer. And the best one is mainstream, and that is something that you put in like a cylinder in your tubings. Then you have to make some assumptions. That was the word that I was looking for before. And that is that the effective lung volume and cardiac output are constant from one breath to another. It's just about 6 seconds apart. So this is a fairly reasonable assumption, in fact. It also says that the concentration of carbon dioxide in mixed venous blood, the blood coming back from the body, going to the alveoli, will remain about constant during this cycle of 10 breaths. That will be about a minute. And that is also a fairly reasonable assumption. And the main limitation is that if you have parts of the lungs that have collapsed, that is called atelectasis in clinical language, that means that there is no air going into this part of the lung, like a lobe. Or if you say that one entire lung has collapsed, there is no gas going into that lung, but there is still blood flow to a certain extent going through. And that will not be oxygenated, and that will not be able to give off carbon dioxide. And that is called shunt flow. And it does not see shunt flow. So you need to have a lung that is open. All about this, the $10 million question is, does this in fact work? So this is the first study we did in rabbits together with Walid Haber, who is a very nice friend and professor in Geneva, who has a respiratory lab down there. So we went down there and checked this out. And what did we do? So we used various PEEP levels, and I said that PEEP, increasing PEEP will increase FRC, decreasing PEEP will reduce FRC. So we then used various PEEP levels. We used the ELV, our capnodynamic method, compared that with the EELV, which is FRC, when you are on mechanical ventilation, and that we use this helium wash-in, wash-out method that you can do in the lab, but not in the clinic. We randomized the order of the PEEPs. Then we made the lung lavage. We filled the lungs with saline a couple of times, out, and then you flush out surfactant. And surfactant, if you remember, is the surface tension reducing element that provides homogeneous ventilation in the lung. And if you wash that out, you get surfactant depletion, and you will produce mild lung injury, you should say. So it's a model of mild lung injury. And we repeated this to see, will these values show approximately the same values? Here you see all the rabbits. On this axis you have our method, the ELV. Here you have the EELV or FRC, same thing, but this is for mechanically ventilated individuals. Here you see the healthy lung. You will see that the ELV will underestimate to a certain extent the FRC or EELV, but they are very parallel. So that underestimation is not too bad. If you look at the mildly injured lung, they're almost perfectly on the line. And that is very, very promising. So we have created the Capno group at the hospital across the street. There's a pediatric one, which I'm part of, and there's also adult one. And the adult side has produced this thesis just a few years ago. Caroline Helgesander, looking at this in how this works in pigs, looking both at the EPBF and ELV. Here you have two reference methods. This is the best, the COTS. I'll come back to that in a little bit. This is thermodilution with the pulmonary artery catheter. You can do very invasive things to pigs. And this green one is our method, new method. And here you see cardiac output. You have baseline. We have put in a balloon in the cava that we can blow up, and that will then reduce venous return and preload. The heart cannot pump more when, except what it gets back. So this is then depriving the heart of venous return. Blood pressure should go down. It goes down. You give phenylephrine, which is a drug that increases peripheral vascular resistance. Nothing much happens when you deflated the balloon. You look at the vasodilator. They still work. They show pretty much the same. You give dobutamine, which is a cardiac stimulant drug. It's an inotropic drug that makes the heart pump stronger and more. And you see, you get the expected increase in cardiac output. And all these methods follow each other. You give a volume load, you increase preload, cardiac output should go up, it does go up, and then you bleed the pigs, and it goes down. So this is extremely fascinating to see how our method is able to follow these two. This is the laboratory gold standard, this is the clinically gold standard. I'm going late. And you can also see, this is a way to see how well you trend. If one method is going in a positive way, the other should also go in a positive way. If it's reduced, it should go in the... So you should have your values in these two quadrants, not in these. If they're here, it's not good. But you can see that this trends in a very, very nice way. I will just see... I have a few minutes more. This is then looking at is there a difference between if you use the inspiratory hold mechanism to provide this modification of the breath or the expiratory hold. If you look at cardiac output, if you do an expiratory hold, you will then be in an expiratory pause for a longer period of time. And that will not impede venous return. If you have an inspiratory pause, you will increase the pressure in the thoracic cavity, and that might be worse. So if you then instead choose an expiratory hold, and you look at all these manipulations compared to the laboratory standard, they are almost identical. I think I will stop with this slide. I have plenty more, but you will have to go to other lectures and stuff, and we will have to have some time for questions. If you have large swings in cardiac output, there has been certain other research groups saying that your ELV determinations might be affected, so it cannot really predict well if you have very big fluctuations in circulation. So then we looked at this again. healthy and then mildly sick lungs after lavage. Here you have baseline, you decrease cardiac output and then increase cardiac output by pharmacolay or cable occlusion and tubivitamin, as we said before. And you can see that that does not in fact affect effective lung volume at all. We do it at the P5 level and then at the P12 level, and you see the same thing. The lung is getting injured, and then, as I said in the beginning, your FRC is going down, but it doesn't change at either of these peak levels. So it's very stable and it works even during big cardiac or hemodynamic changes. And it also trends again very, very well. I will just leave you with this. I will not go into detail, but this is my PhD student that just finally passed his PhD thesis defense on the 5th of April. And this is in fact where we have taken this to children, showing that it does work even in the clinical situation. And we're doing a lot more interesting stuff. We can deduce other very interesting cardiovascular parameters like mixed venous saturation. That is the next project that we're going to embark on, try to find a new PhD person. And then also another thing that we would like to do is to see if we can get this to work also in patient breathing patients, or humans at least, breathing spontaneously. Maybe you will have to be alert and awake enough to do a breathing pattern, but that might be possible to do. So thank you very much for your attention, and if you have any questions, I'm happy to try to answer them. Thank you.